गुड मॉर्निंग सर, योर स्क्रीन इज विजिबल।
ओके गुड गुड ओके सो आई थिंक वी डिड द फर्स्ट क्लास एंड वी आर गॉन थ्रू द बेसिक बैंकिंग द कमर्शियल बैंक सब्जेक्ट एज आई टोल्ड इन द फर्स्ट क्लास फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ सम ऑफ यू जॉइन द क्लास व्हाट वी लुक एट इज द इवोल्यूशन ऑफ बैंकिंग How the banking has been evolved over a period of time we have gone through. Especially there have been few prominent concept which is Babylonian, currently part of Iraq and ancient Egypt, which is one of the North African country, Egypt. Then medieval Italian cities, London goes. I think these are if you look at the evolvement of banking. From before Christ, I think you probably aware. I told you the period. I think we have records till 2000 BC. That means BC means before Christ. So we are in Anno Domini 2021. We are talking about 4,000 to 5,000 years ago. How the banking has been evolved over a period of time. So during these periods are prominent according to the old records available. So some of the Babylonian concept. Where these hours have been stored in a generally stored in a warehouse. Those warehouses were used as bigger church and palaces because these are bigger building and have some security features added because the priests are there in a church and there are guards are in the palaces. So these bigger building was found to be whatever the valuable they have probably in the form of commodities. To protect them, so that have been evolved when they started issuing receipt. Whenever things are kept under the custody of these big buildings, then medieval Italian cities during this period, the loan concept have been developed, and there was a concept of levying or charging interest was found during this period. Then the London Goldsmith, where the real banking concept developed in the London Goldsmith period, where it's a fractional reserve. Then what happens is the people who started during that Goldsmith time, there have been gold and bronze and silver. These metals were found and these metals are used as a mode of exchange. What happens before prior to using mode of exchange, who have excess these gold, what they do is they go and keep it in the goldsmith and get a receipt. So over a period of time, the goldsmith realized all the goods were kept there and these people never come to withdraw. So what has really happened, the receipt that have been given by goldsmith for the receipt of gold had been circulated among the communities and started used as official exchange. Then the goldsmith realized the gold kept by people for safekeeping had never been taken, or only a fractional part of it had been taken. So most of them are there. Then they thought, why can't they make use of it? They started lending the gold. Then they started issuing receipt on behalf of the gold there because they know the receipts have been circulated. So they started issuing receipts against those gold reserves. That is how the fractional banking concept developed during the goldsmith period. Even if it's now, if you think of the banking, real banking. So the people, what bank does is bank take the depositors' money, and bank very well aware by the expertise, by their experience in the banking, every depositors will not take their money. Some of them, of course, they do. So what happens when people come and deposit money? Bank is very well aware a fraction of it will be taken, so they keep the liquidity in the form of cash, and the balance they started lending. So that concept is found in the London Goldsmith period. So where the goldsmith started issuing receipts, later he found he has issued more receipts than the gold that was in possession. So that is how the actual banking concept also. We really look at it, if the people come and deposit the money, bank gone and lend to the money to different people. So if really look at it, every depositors come and demand the money at once, bank will not have enough liquidity to refund. So that is the fractional reserve. So that is how the banks are functioned. So that was found in during this recognized evolvement process in the banking history, right? Then we found what is money, what are the attribution to the money. I think most of you know what is money, what are the attribution to the money, the functions of money. Yes, of course, it works as a medium of exchange, because when you want to buy something, you have to give the money as a medium of exchange for you to obtain goods or services. That's one medium of exchange. And unit of account, yes, you can do the accounting. Is possible when the mode of exchange as a money had been invented, that could be used as to do your accounting, right? So it was not possible in a barter economy, where your accounts is not possible because people do exchange their commodity with some other to another person and exchange different needs. So the barter economy had been there in the older days. That probably the barter economy system would have been successful with a limited wants and need community. And when the civilized people are civilized, and when the thinking pattern innovations have been taken place, then the barter economy shortcomings were gradually found, and they had been a necessary. They have to go for a common mode of exchange. That is how the money has been used. I think if you look back the history, there have been instances stones have been used as money. Then the leaves of some of the tobacco leaves also been history. The salt have been used as money. So likewise, they have taken different commodity used as money, but each one had its own problem. So they would have found, okay, the gold and the silver and the bronze, that was in existence for some time, maybe 200 to 300 years, the gold was being used as money, maybe more than that, right? So that had been used. Then later they found, okay, it's hard to carry, there's been scarcity in the gold, then they would have gone for a paper money. That is how the money had been invented. Of course, the banking is much, much predated to the money, right? The banking concept was, but whenever you have excess, you need to go to somewhere to keep that as a safekeeping. That is the concept of banking, right? Then we also saw attribution to the money, its accessibility, uniformity, stability in value, you can divisibility. Yes, this was not available in the barter economy. Durability, portability, all should be there, right? Then we look at financial structure in Sri Lanka, how the financial entities, I think we look at this financial structure of here, the apex entity, central bank, its top of in the financial system. Then you have, there are licensed commercial banks, specialized bank, finance company, leasing company, right? All these are coming under the purview of central bank, but that there are other security, unit trust, those primary dealers, all those entities are also part of the financial structure. Then we look at it, the organization that come under the purview of the central bank, these are the organizations, the licensed banks. That means there are two kind of banks, licensed commercial bank and a specialized bank, that is called licensed bank. Then you have licensed finance company, leasing company, micro primary dealers in government securities. Then you have authorized dealer for foreign exchange. Then you have limited, there are people who are doing in money changes, brokers, those are restricted dealers. They are not a fully fledged dealer, right? Money changes are restricted dealers because they can only carry out limited activity, right? So that is what all this part of financial, if you look at the financial system, majority of the financial organization coming under the purview of regulator, which is central bank. Then we also saw that there are other entities also regulating the financial system in Sri Lanka, which is called Security Exchange Commission. That you can, all the public quoted company need to be registered, governed under the Security Exchange. Then stockbrokers, dealers, unit trust companies, all this investment, all that comes under Security Exchange. Then we have a other body called, it's previously called IBS, the Insurance Board of Sri Lanka. Now the new name is process Insurance Regulatory Commission of Sri Lanka. They are the regulator for insurance businesses and related business entities, right? Then we look at central bank. There are two primary objectives of central bank: achieving economy and price stability of rupees, and the financial system stability. So these are the two major objectives of central bank. So central bank is functioning based on these two objectives. Of course, they do different functions, but their main objective is the, these are the two objectives, right? Achieving economy stability, or that means the rupee value need to be stable. Now the LKR currency what we use, the central bank want to ensure the rupee what we use are always stable. Then the financial system, which we talk about, all the organization comes under central bank, comes under different regulatory body. That is the entire financial system. So you should have a sound financial system for you to do your banking. If you don't have the sound financial system, what happens? Then the confidence on the financial system collapse. People do not have any confidence to go and keep their money with the bank, or people do not have any confidence to buy securities of those public quoted companies. They don't have any faith, because the financial system stability should be very strong and sound. So that, how that aspect is monitored by the regulator. So the regulators need to ensure these are the two major objectives, right? Then we also saw how the monetary board, which is the governing body of central bank, consists of, there are five strong members. One is governor, then there is other person called secretary to the Ministry of Finance. He's ex officio, he's carrying two roles. He's a part of monetary board as well as is a common role as a secretary to the Ministry of Finance. Then there are other three non-executive members, which is appointed by the president of the country. So that is, that is how the boards are, the monetary boards are run by. So the chairman of the board is the governor. So the governor is the top person in the central bank, and he is also a chairperson of the monetary board. So the governor holding two positions as a governor of the central bank and also chairman of the monetary board. And there are other four members, you should know, ministry, secretary to the ministry, and two non-executive member appointed by the president on the recommendation of the Ministry of Finance. That is how the monetary board consists of, right? Then we saw co-function, conduct monetary policy. We saw the central bank issues rates on a regular basis, which is the basement of an interest rate regime. You have two rates that have been issued. I think we looked at the rate. Then they also conduct exchange rate policy, because you know this nowadays there's a lot of pressure on foreign exchange. We are having a very limited foreign reserves, so there's a lot of pressure on foreign exchange. So central bank is doing their level best to ensure the foreign exchange rate is safeguarded. Then when we look at a country like us, we are more towards imports than our export income. So we have more expenditure on imports than our export income. So countries, developing country features, their trade balance. When you say trade balance, it's the total export and import is called trade balance. So always our trade balance are deficit. That means, in other words, our income expenditure is more than the our expenditure, import expenditure is almost double the export income. So whenever you do export goods or services, you earn foreign exchange into the country. But that foreign exchange also have been spent to buy goods and services from overseas. So we are buying more goods and services to consume than the goods and services we export and earn foreign exchange. So our foreign exchange is always in deficit. If you take the trade balance, always is deficit. That is the reason you could see we have foreign reserve for next 2 to 3 months only. This again, after a lot of curtailment put to the imports. So you know there are commodities which cannot be imported right now. Right. So, example, motor vehicles, other luxury goods have been totally banned. Maybe 1 year, the vehicle is almost closer to 1 year and closer to 1.5 years now, right? So, it has been stopped since February 2000, right? So, it's more than 1.5 months, it's 1.5 year, the vehicle is totally banned. So, by doing that, they preserve some foreign exchange, because if you reduce, you need to reduce your import expenditure, because knowing that your export incomes are got affected, because the major income the country earns are from limited sources, goods, by exporting goods and services we earn foreign exchange. Then tourism, where the foreigners come and spend their money here as an attraction, tourist attraction. Then we have our worker remittances, our expatriate workers, maybe blue collar, maybe white collar. You know what is the meaning of these two? They have a blue collar mean, there's a laborers and other sort of assistance of helping these kind of work. White collar mean, these people holding an official capacity, I live in an official environment, working in an official environment. So there are two type of workforce we have. So these are the expatriate workers who earn foreign exchange. So you can see the blue collar people, most of them got affected. Those are the people send more money because they are living average life. So they need to look after their dependents. So they whatever earn, they send it there. That got affected very badly. Most of them, due to this pandemic situation, most of the workers lost their job. They are here now. So you could see the income that what we generate badly got affected. Our exports, goods and services are also facing challenges, and there's no tourism at all. And the worker remittances for the expatriate workers who are working and sending their money also curtailment. That also has a contraction. So what happened as a result, you need to reduce your imports. That is how the government is doing their measures to reduce the import. There's no other way. If you really think logically, when you have income to your purse and when you have a curtailment of whatever the money coming into your purse wallet, then your spending also will have to be reduced accordingly. Otherwise, you will be a bankrupt person. That means you're owing money from others, and one fine day you won't be able to settle whatever asset you have. If you sell it, even you can't sell your debit. So the moment a country or a person having more debt than what he possesses, he is declared as a bankrupt person. Insolvency, you call it as insolvency. That person cannot be repay his debt. Then he will become a bankrupt country. So unfortunately, we need to accept that we have been struggling to repay our loan, making every effort to repay the loans. So I think the foreign credit rating agencies have found that we don't have enough foreign reserve, so they think that we might struggle to repay our loans. Therefore, they had reduced our credit rating. So that is impacted a lot to the country. When the credit rating of a country is downgraded, I think we are in the C categories. C categories, almost default category. Almost in default category. So countries are in AAA, AA. I think I will show you, there is a slide there. So if you have that kind of a environment, we are far below now. We have been ranked lower, almost in the default category. So when a country is downgraded, there is a lot of issues the country has to go through. It's very, very difficult to import and export, especially when you do imports. The seller always insists, because he is dealing with a risky country, because the country is considered a high-risk country, because they don't have foreign reserves. So he will be always dictate terms. He should receive the money before he sends the goods. So that a lot of challenge on importers. So that is where central bank comes in to monitor the foreign reserves, right? Then they overlook the financial system by supervision, continuous supervision. Then to function, they issue the money national distribution of the national currency system by central bank. They compile the dissemination of economic data, because when the budget is prepared, you know, all these statistics are extracted from central bank. The financial advisory to the government is the central bank role. So then agency function. So central bank also do some agency function, management of public debt. That means public debt means government borrowing from public by issuing treasury bill and treasury bond. Treasury bills are short-term borrowing, treasury bonds are long-term borrowing. So when the government wants funds, they borrow it from the general public by issuing treasury bill and treasury bond. That function is done by the department called public debt department in central bank. Central bank has different departments. One prominent department is public debt department. The other department is banking supervision department. Banking supervision department is very, very powerful unit of the central bank. They are the people monitoring the licensed banks, right?
When the government need the money, they will sell the treasury bond, no?
Sorry?
When the government need the money, they will send the treasury bond, no?
Yeah. When the government wants funds, so they issue. That is how they borrow from public. So as far as you are as a public person, you have opportunity to invest your money in the bank, or you have the opportunity invest in treasury bill and treasury bond. All depend how safe you feel. If you feel the banking systems are not stronger, but the government, you go for a treasury bill and treasury bond. Depends. So anyway, it's one of the safest way of investing money is the treasury bill and treasury bond. Is that clear?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So that is how the funds are the foreign exchange, the public debt department does the issuance of treasury bill and treasury bonds. Foreign exchange, yeah, buying and selling foreign exchange is foreign exchange management. Then of course the EPF. I think I explained to you what is EPF. EPF is Employee Provident Fund. So when you are working in any entity in Sri Lanka, if you are in a permanent employee of any of those employer, what happens? From your salary, 8% is deducted. From your salary, say let's say you are working in a company for 20,000 salary. So when you are in the permanent payroll of that particular company, so you are working, you have been paying 20,000. End of the day, when you get your salary, you could see there is a 8% deducted from your salary. So what is 8%? 1,600 rupees deducted from your salary. So you found your 10,000, 8% is deducted. 20,000, 1,600 is deducted. That means 8% deducted from your total salary. So that 1,600 plus, they have to put other 12%. The employer has to put 12% of your basic salary. So if your basic salary considered 20,000, they put other 12%, which is other 2,400 plus your 1,600. Eventually, 20% of your salary is set aside as an EPF. So that money has to be go to central bank. There is a department monitoring on behalf of the entire general public. The government has given that role to the central bank. Okay, you maintain the funds of EPF, Employee Provident Fund. So that is, they are the custodian of the Employee Provident Fund. What is Employee Provident Fund? Each and every employee, when they're working, they, from their salary, 8% is deducted, and the employer has to put on top of that, he has to put other 12%. So in other words, if you are drawing 20,000 rupees salary, from your salary, 4,000 rupees, which is 20%. Your 8% plus employer 12%, both together 20%. So 20% of your 20,000 salary, which is 4,000 rupees, set aside every month. When your salary is increased, based on that, the 8% will also adjust it. So you will be more contributing. So the more the salary you draw, your EPF contribution will be also more. So what happens? That EPF funds will be invested by the EPF, that the particular department, that the central bank, invest the money, the EPF money, into various investment, and the return, whatever they get, that's also given to the member. So in other words, every year, there is an interest component coming to your accumulated fund. So what happens when you work for 25 years, 30 years, when you end of your career, when you come to the retirement age, you will have a substantial money under your EPF account, which you can claim it after 55 to 60 years, depending on the tenure of service that I've been permitted to work in certain organization. In Sri Lanka, certain organization, retirement age is 55. There are certain organization going up to 60. Generally, government organization, mostly 60 years. So you can work up to 60 years, then you will claim your EPF, right? That funds also looked after by the central bank, right? Then facilitating financial inclusion means wherever there is non-banking, central bank want them to coming into the banking system. That is good inclusion. You have to include them into the financial system. That is the meaning of financial inclusion. So wherever you feel non-banking, there are other, if you take rural part, and there are, most of the people do not have the bank account. So central bank want them to coming into the financial system. So if you attract them, if you ask them to open account, give little bit of a literacy, the Wahoo savings are going to be important. That part is expected by central bank, they're expecting from commercial bank to expand. So that is how the central bank, the commercial bank, putting branches all over the places. Why? They have to develop not only the cities, but urban and other areas too. Then only you have a total development. You can't say Colombo city is developed and the other part is not developed. That doesn't mean development. So the entire country needs to be developed. Every region has to have the banking concept. Everything should be there. Otherwise, the region cannot. So that is financial inclusion. That means the people who are non-banking crowd should be taken into banking crowd. That is also part of the role. That is why central bank always tell the commercial bank, when you open a branch, they say, okay, you open a branch in this area. You open a branch. Maybe one of the commercial bank want to increase their branch within Colombo area. But central bank will say, reject that request, and they might say, no, you go and open a branch at Kupalam or Chilau or whatever the site they feel less banking. There are more people, less banking. So that is what you call financial. That is also their role. Then intelligence. Yeah, there's money laundering. There is a money laundering. I just explained the other day. Just let me, because I saw there's some of you joined today, so that is the reason I'm just briefing you the first session, before we continue our usual session, then I can take everybody into the one platform. Otherwise, I'm leaving you and going, then you will not get the fund foundation, right? What is money laundering? So the money laundering is where the money is derived from illegal activity, say drug traffic, kidnapping, killing. Okay, all these are unethical activities. So when the monies are derived from, or the unpaid tax money, black money, you call it, whenever you have to pay taxes, you pay without paying taxes, you hiding the money. Those monies are you call black money. So these kind of money should not coming into the bank account. So what happened? That is what the anticipation of the government. So here what happened? There are different way you could see these money are coming into the banking channel. Once the money is coming, after coming to the banking channel, it become a white money. When you say white money, it is a legal money. So the what is money laundering? Money laundering is money that have been derived from bad activities coming into the banking channel is called money laundering. So that money laundering need to be stopped. That is what you call anti-money laundering, AML. You call it as AML. So the banks are fighting for money laundering, anti-money laundering. So you call it AML. Then you also know what is AML. How do the bank can do the AML? They need to have the KYC of the customer. What is KYC stand for? Know your customer. So that is become part and parcel of the law. In 2006, 5 to 6 period, there are a lot of acts were passed in Sri Lanka. I think there were 3 acts passed by Parliament. Because that was that period was entire globally much more than that. Globally the banks were used to launder money laundered monies were deposited through different banks. Then they went through a lot of difficulties. There'd be a lot of failure on the banking. Then later every country started having their own policies to fight for this money laundering and fight for this terrorist money, the money that have been derived from terrorist activities. Unethical activities should not allow to coming into the banking channel. That is what you call money laundering. So we are fighting for money laundering. That is what you sometimes you can say AML KYC. You can these two words go hand in hand. AML means anti-money laundering. What is KYC? Know your customer. For you to do the money laundering, you should know the customer. So the fundamental is you should know the customer. KYC is know your customer. So I think when that is become part and parcel of the law, you can see when you open account, there is a KYC form attached. Why do you fill the KYC form? Because you are telling the bank, this is my history behind. So whenever there is anything unusual amount coming to that particular person's account, bank should immediately make a query. Take example, one A coming to open a bank account and he says, I want to open a bank account. My purpose of opening bank account to save my extra money. So he's drawing salary and 50,000. He has to mention everything in the KYC form. His name, address, all to every information, including his employment, what is the salary, what is the purpose of opening account, what is his income level, everything he has to declare in the KYC form. So the moment you get all the first-hand information from the KYC form, and when the in reality, when the account is opened in different manner, the bank should check it. That is what central bank wanted bank to have the KYC form. You know your customer, and then you look at the transaction, whether the KYC form and the transactions are reconciled. If that doesn't reconcile, there's an issue. There is something wrong with the account. That is how you identify the illegal transaction. So that is what bank fill the KYC, ask the customer to fill the KYC form, because they should know what is their source of income customer, what is the purpose he's opening the account, what is his income level. Then substantially, I'll continue the example. Say A opened the account with the intention to save his money. His income level, he has put 100,000, 75,000 to 100,000 is income level. Now, right, so every time 10,000, 15,000 comes, so then you don't have any problem because you know it is extra saving. All of a sudden, 5 million comes, there are other 2 million coming into the account. Bank should put, the customer should put inquiry, where is the money, where is this coming from? Then the customer should have a valid answer. There could be genuine transaction. Say his brother sent some money for him to buy a land. That's a genuine transaction. As far as he comes and tells the bank, this 5 million has come from my brother, this is how he sends it, and there's no problem. But if the particular person is unable to furnish the legitimacy of the transaction, then there's a doubt. Then those transactions need to be reported to central bank. That is what those three acts that have been passed in Parliament in 2005-06 period insisting bank has to report this suspicious transaction. So banks are reporting. They can't pick and choose what is suspicious. They will. There is a threshold. More than 1 million transactions are getting reported. That doesn't mean the transaction below 1 million are not money laundered. There are instances, because then banks should have their own system to detect those transactions. Say a particular person getting the money every month, about 100 payments coming to his account. Various people sending the money, small amount, because then it not get detected to the reporting requirement. With reporting requirement, anything 1 million over, he is very well aware if the transactions are less than 1 million, nothing will get reported. But the bank should have their own AML KYC system, compliance team in the bank. I think you aware, people who are working in the bank knows there is department called compliance department. What is their role? To scrutinize this account and see where unusual credits are coming to the account. If those things comes, you have to be careful and identify and report it to central bank. That is where. Then also regional development, as I told you, that is called financial inclusion for ensure. Economic price stability, this is very important to ensure the price stability of the country. So you know the Sri Lanka rupee is always depreciating against dollar. What does it mean? Why our rupee value is deteriorating, or why it is getting against the dollar, why is getting depreciated, what is the reason? That reflection is coming from the economy, stability of the economy. So I told you the example. Now we have currency notes, you would have seen the currency note, right? 20, 50, 100, then we have 500, we have then 1,000, we have gone up to 5,000. Then I quoted this example. If you take USA, what is the highest denomination? I think some of you answered 100. 100 is the highest denomination of USA. See how strong the dollar. That is what everybody use the dollar. Why? The economy is so strong, their currency maximum unit is 100. So that shows their stability. The reflection of their economy stability shown from the currency itself. Their dollar remain 100 for more than 5-6 decades. Still they insist 100. They never go for anything more than 100. But look at our country, like Asian countries, most of the developing countries. We are printing money. Then what happened? There is no value for that money. If you look at 5,000 rupees, absolutely nothing. Then why the value is depreciating? That is because the inflation. So the purchasing power of a particular currency is diminishing over a period of time. That reflects the inflation in the country. Though officially our inflation rate is very nominal, but in reality the inflation is very, very high. Very, very high. That is what everybody feels, because I think I explained to you, when you take some money and go to a particular supermarket, you purchase certain things. If you take the same money after 2 months and if you go to same supermarket to purchase the same thing, you won't be able to purchase, right? So you will be purchasing less. That means the purchasing power of your money is coming down every day. In other words, general price levels are increasing. That is the reason. When the general price levels are increasing, the purchasing power of the currency is coming down. That is called inflation. So when the inflations are there, eventually the rupee will get depreciate against the foreign currency. That is where the economy stability. That is what central banks struggling to keep the rupee stability strong. Then they are unable to do these two external factors. The economy is such, we are solely dependent on imports. Then we need to have a system. Our policies should be stable. Unfortunately, some of the policies are not stable. If you take our policy, very, very frequent changes are taking place. But if you really look at it in developed country, their policies are maybe 1 year, they will issue about 4 or 5 direction only. Nothing more than that. That is very stable. But if you take our country, I think every year we issue about 50 to 60 or maybe closer to 100 direction, 100 circulars, 100 gazettes. That doesn't reflect good on the governance, because we are keep on changing our policies. That is the reason these frequent communications are taking. It has to be very strong policies. If we take USA, now you could see how the country currency become mentioned. Look at the USA. About 2 years ago, they were struggling with the pandemic. Where are they today? That is show stability. They have enough of plenty of reserves. That is what the currency is very strong. Whatever happened to their economy, they will immediately, quickly turn around and they will come to the normalcy. So that is where the currency stability. So central bank also try their level best to keep the rupee stable. That is one of the primary objectives of the central bank, but they are striving to achieve due to whatever external factors are not conducive, not in favor to keep the rupee stable, but they try their level best, right? Financial system stability. What does it mean to you? Financial system stability means the financial system has to be very strong. Yeah, as I told you, bank supervision department go and check the bank. Are they following direction issued by? Are they keep as per the direction issued by central bank, especially keeping the capital, keeping the liquidity position, SRR, statutory reserve ratio. That mean I think. Let me explain when it comes. Then all those prudent requirements are fulfilled by the commercial banks, licensed bank. So that is why the financial system stability. You can't have any failure of bank. If one bank is failed, that will have a bad impact to the financial system. I think you would have seen some time ago, maybe last 2 to 3. If you look at the last 5 to 6 years, there were a lot of finance company went into trouble. Almost they were shut down, right? Why? Because they were unable to repay the depositors' money. Because they were offering higher rate for the deposit. So the financial companies were struggling and they were bankrupt. They were declared bankrupt. Then the government took the responsibility to repay the depositors' money. Because when you are offering a rate, you need to be aware of. As a general public also, you should know when the bank FD rates are 4% to 5%. The 1% is okay, 4 to 5%. That is the average. Maybe some bank might give 4.5, some bank might give 4.75, or some bank might give 5. That's fine. That is the normal. But in an environment like that, if a finance company come and say, I'm offering 9%, I'm offering 11%, that is abnormal. There can't be a situation like that. Everybody functioning in the same economy. How can that particular organization going to give 9%? Then you should know there is a high risk by keeping the money in that finance company. You might even lose your capital. That's what exactly happened to these people who deposit the money, thinking that they get more interest to the finance company. They went and deposit the Arden money. Then they lost the money. Even they lost their capital. So remember, you have to be very prudent when you make your investment. You have to be very selective. The standing behind the organization, that stability need to be established by the regulator. That is what, when the finance company in trouble, central bank immediately intervened and they said the depositor, no worry, we will take the asset of the company, we'll sell it, whatever we recover, and we'll try to pay a portion of it or whatever, right? When there had been a situation like this, then when finance companies are failing, there are thinking among the general public, why can't this effect can come into the banking sector? If a bank also fail, what will happen? When people start thinking, then there is a tendency or reluctancy people to keep their money in the bank too. So about 4 to 5 years ago, this was the situation. Then central bank thought, okay, we have to get rid of this mentality. If the people start thinking, this particular contagious effect can go into the banking sector, then the depositors will lose the confidence. Then central bank brought, in order to eradicate that concept, central bank brought something called deposit insurance scheme. Deposit insurance scheme means central bank said, okay, every bank has to deposit, make an insurance out of their own money. They have to insure their depositors. So if the bank is even found a later date to be closed down, the depositors are protected by the insurance company. The insurance company will pay the depositor. So the bank take the insurance policy on behalf of all the depositors. And even the bank failure, depositors will be assured by the insurance company. So they are tying up the insurance policy. So now the people are confident. They know that even if their bank fail, they get their money. Of course, there is a limitation. We will see that limitation. There is a limit. Up to that limit, they will get the insurance paid by the right. So that is how we look at it. Role of the central bank in maintaining financial system. I told you, central bank. The role of the central bank is to ensure the financial system safety, and they act as a last lender to last resort in the event when there is financial difficulties. The bank is not in a position to repay the depositors. I think these kind of things come when you hear a bad news of a particular bank. Every depositors go and try to demand the money. So if a situation happen, then you know the bank do not have every money, because the whatever the money they have taken from the depositors, they have gone and granted loans to the outsiders. If the outsiders are using that money in the form of asset, they bought businesses, they bought assets, they bought land, then all of a sudden if the depositors come and demand the money, bank do not have enough money to repay them. Then that is the problem, right? So if the problem comes, then they don't have any way to go. Only central bank comes and rescue them in the problem, right? Central bank come and they will acting as a lender to the last resort. So they will comes as a finally, they will rescue the bank by lending whatever the deficit they have. Central bank will lend them and rescue from the problem. That is what called lender to last resort. The only lender to last resort in banks are central bank, because they are the only authority. They will come and rescue the bank. That is what happened. If you really look at it, in European countries, about 78 years ago, Greece was one of the European countries. They were in the European Union. So Greece went into problem. The country almost shut down, almost bankrupt. So since they are in the European Union, there are powerful countries in the European, like German, France, Italy, Finland, all these, Austria, these countries were there in the European Union. So they bail out. They bail out mean they rescue that country. Otherwise, the entire European Union is going to suffer. So same thing happened. If one bank fail in the system, entire financial system going to collapse. So central bank should not allow that to happen. That is what their role as a lender to last resort. In the event of a bank is about to crash, they will give the money and rescue the bank. That operation is called lender of last resort, right? So I think then we went through this. This was the last slide we discussed. There have been rates offered by central bank regularly. These rates are reviewed. I think I have put the review. I updated this slide. If you have your own slide, make sure the last review was done in this month. They were keeping the rate same level. Same level. Probably the next, every, I think once a month they do it. Maybe they have a 10 to 12 review per annum. So they review regularly of the interest rate they can offer. So what is this interest rates? What, there are two interest rates. You call standing deposit facility rate. Then you have standing lending facility rate. So remember, when there is a liquidity required in the economy, when there is a, that there can, there are two situations that could happen. Where in an economy, there's an excess liquidity. So when there is an excess liquidity, that need to be deposited with the central bank. The excess liquidity will be absorbed by the central bank by offering standing deposit rate. So if the banking sector has enough liquidity, lot of monies are going around. So central bank come and take that money in the form of a deposit. The bank can keep the excess money with the central bank. They will pay 4.5%. That is standing deposit rate. Let's say in an economy, there's a shortage. There is no money there. Then central bank comes and injects money. That means they come and lending to the banks by offering 5.5 lending rate. So remember, lending rate, central bank pumping money to the economy. Deposit rate, central bank taking, absorbing excess liquidity in the market by offering 4.5 and taking the money with them. So these two situations could definitely could happen in the economy depending on the situation. So there could be situation there a shortage, there could be situation excess liquidity. Accordingly, central bank, that is how the rates are also fixed, 4.5, 5.5. Then there is something called statutory reserve ratio. SRR, you should know this. This is a foundation of the banking, right? What is SRR? 2% currently. It was about 6%, like about 1 year ago, 1.5 year ago. Then it was reduced to 4%. Now, currently, very, very low. It's very low. I think never in the history, the SRR went up to this lower. Even the standing deposit rates and the facility rates always double digit. Now, you could see they are very far, very, very below. Single digit, very below rate, 4.5, 5.5. So what does it mean to you? In other words, central bank trying to keep the interest rate very lower level. So they feel this is the better combination. Then people can, when the rates are lower, remember there is a credit. People can borrow money from the bank to do their businesses. So that is the anticipation, right? And what is statutory reserve ratio? Statutory mean it's a mandatory. Statutory mean it's a mandatory. What does it mean? Whenever you take bank, whenever they take deposit, they have to keep a certain percentage of the deposit with central bank in cash form. That is what you call statutory reserve ratio. Take example, if a person come and deposit 100 rupees, every deposit, every 100 rupees deposits, they have to keep 2% with central bank in cash form, right? So that 2% kept in central bank, that is in the event of a crisis, when this particular bank do not have liquidity, at least that statutory reserve will support them to get the bank back into the track. So that is the purpose. And also, not only to that, and also it added, it's a one of the monetary mechanism tool or policy tool. What does it mean? If the central bank wants more lending to be given to the economy by banks, what they will do? They will reduce the rate. If the central bank feels there are banks are giving more credit, they want to reduce the capacity, the lending capacity of the bank, they will increase the rate. So take example, if you have a 100 rupee deposit, if a SRR rate is 6%, then what will happen? You have to keep 6 rupees with central bank. Then you have to keep other 10 rupees for your immediate cash requirement. Then you are left over 10 plus 6, you have left over only 84 to lend. Right? 84 to lend. So you have 84 rupees to lend. Now look at it, now only 2%. Now look at it, you have 88 to lend. You got 10 and 2, 12. Out of 100, you have to keep 2 rupees with central bank and 10 rupees for the withdrawal of the depositors. You have 88 to lend. So when the rates SRR are lesser, you have more lending capacity. When the SRR is more, your lending capacity will be reduced, because this is how they manage the monetary mechanism tool. So this is how the central bank manage the interest rate plus the capacity to increase the credit or reduce the credit. That is what you call monitoring tool. These are one monitoring tool by adjusting this rate. There is a bank rate. What is this bank rate? I told you, when there is a crisis of a bank, they are unable to pay the depositors money, they can go to the bank and borrow. And that time bank charge 8.5, because this bank didn't keep the required money. So that is what they charge at a higher interest rate against their whatever assets. They will lend to rescue the bank at the rate of 8.5. That is you call bank rate. So when there's a crisis, when the bank is unable to repay the depositors' money, they can go to the central bank and borrow at the rate of 8.5 in order to repay the depositor. Because they charge as a fine to this particular bank. Why? They have to keep a certain liquidity ratio. So if they lend everything, they are short of liquidity because they are unable to repay the depositor. Then they have been declared as offense. They did offense. For that, there is a fine. That is the reason they charge 8.5%. Right? Remember, these monetary rates are reviewed every once in a month, at least 10 times per year, or once in 2 months, they definitely review this rate. Right? Okay. Now, banking sector, I think we have to commence from here. I spend almost 1 hour to explain. Hello? Somebody? Hello?
Hello?
Hello, yes?
Is there any relation between SLF power and bank rate?
Relation between?
SLFR and bank rate?
No. There's no relation. There, because that is the fine. When you say no relation in the sense, it's like this. If there's no direct relation. But remember, when these rates are regularly reviewed, let's say this stand-in deposit rate have been gone to 8.5%. The stand-in lending has gone up to 9.5%, then you can't have bank rate 8.5. Definitely, it will be adjusted according to. There's no direct relationship, but this rate will be vary according to the, whenever the rates are reviewed, if the rates are increased, accordingly, the bank rate also will get adjusted. Is that correct? You understood? Am I answering the question?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Accordingly, the bank also will get adjusted. Right. Okay. Banking sector. So the banking sector in Sri Lanka, which comprise of licensed commercial bank, licensed specialized bank, they are the major two banking sector dominating the financial system, right? So I think more than 60% of the financial systems are banking sector. So more than 60% is owned by the bank, dominated by the banking sector. Banks play a critical role. Yeah, definitely the bank is playing a critical role in an economy because they provide the liquidity, they provide the loans to the customers in the bank, right? So the Laotian Commercial Bank, they provide services to individual as well as businesses. They offer, they take deposit in the form of current account, savings account, term deposit. These are the three accounts you can open with the commercial bank. We will study in detail, but these are the basic accounts you can open. And also bank lend to different people. And also bank do the payment when you want to do import or export. You have to go to commercial bank to do the payments. You can't go to anywhere else because all the international payment, local payment, everything is facilitated through the banking channel. So you have to go. So they do the payment banking, payment also, payment channel or fund transfers, whatever you may call it, according to the destination, right? And also they provide international like opening LCs, issuance of bank guarantees, trade related, import, export, all that financing, everything is done by Laotian Commercial Bank. So the Laotian Commercial Bank offer not with the basic traditional take deposit and loan. No, they have expanded so much into the financial system because with the latest technology development, their delivery also have been expanded drastically. So let us see how these things will happen. Yes, in terms of asset base, if you look at the financial system, the banking sector as the highest, especially Laotian Commercial Bank as the highest combination, highest proposition when you take the total financial system. About 40% of the financial system held by the commercial banks. So you know the how critical role commercial bank plays in an economy, right? They have the highest market share in the financial system, right? So the health of the Sri Lanka finance depending on the large extent of, yes, in Sri Lanka, remember, there are few banks identified as a systemically important bank that you call SIB. What do you mean by systemically important bank? It is not systematically, yeah, it's systemically. Systemically important bank means these are bigger banks. Systemically important banks mean bigger banks. So you call it DSIB. There you put D in front of D mean domestically. Domestically, systemically important bank. Then you, if you put G, globally. So globally systematically important bank. So you know in Sri Lanka, domestically systemically important bank, I think there were four banks. I don't know if you look at the previous slide, I would have put six bank because that six bank got altered to four bank in 1.5 year ago because central bank revived that bigger bank and then categorized four bank. Any idea what are the four banks that being got into SIB in Sri Lanka? What are the four banks? Tell me the names of the banks. Definitely BOC. Bank of City. BOC, yes.
People's Bank.
HNB.
Commercial Bank.
Yes, correct. There were six banks I said earlier. Bank of Ceylon, Commercial, HNB, People's Bank, Sampath and Ceylon. They were the six banks. But later, when they revived this, they have reduced the systematically important bank into four categories. So they put into bucket, right? So that is, there is a requirement when we study, I'll explain to you. For the moment, remember, in Sri Lanka, what do you understand by systemically important bank? Bigger banks, they are too big to fail. Too big to build, they are too big. When they are fail, definitely lot of impact to the economy. See, it's a too big to fail mean, if those people fail, the entire economy will have a suffering because they are so big a bank. So in Sri Lanka, we have four bigger banks. Bank of Ceylon, People's Bank, HNB and Commercial. These are the four bigger banks in Sri Lanka. These banks are called systemically important bank. You put D in front, domestically systemically important bank. If you put G, globally systemically important bank, there are JP Morgan, Citibank, Standard Chartered Bank, Deutsche Bank. These are globally, internationally bigger banks, right? So bigger bank means they have a branch network, they have a customer base, they have an asset base. Based on these factors only, they have been decided are bigger bank, right? In Sri Lanka, we have two type of bank. One is foreign banks having the branches in Sri Lanka, and there are local banks. So I have given you a list. I have given the logo of the bank. You can see 11 foreign banks are there. 11 foreign banks are. It was 13. There were two banks reduced. Can anybody tell me what were the two banks that gone out of these 13 became 11? Can anybody tell me what were the two banks gone out of Sri Lanka? I will support you. Those two banks are Indian banks. Tell me now.
Indian Overseas Bank.
The Indian Overseas Bank still there. Still there. It's, you can see in the list. They are in the list. Now they are no more. I'll tell you the name. These are new players came into Indian market. ICICI Bank is not there in the list. Then Axis Bank. Axis Bank. Right? Axis Bank and ICICI Bank, they came to Sri Lanka very recently. But they couldn't survive because those are newly formed bank. When you take the Indian banking history, about last one or two decades ago, they were started grooming and they tried to capture all over the places. They came here because when they came here, there were already, there are old three banks were there in Sri Lanka. State Bank of India, one of the oldest bank in Sri Lanka. Then Indian Overseas Bank is there. Indian Bank is there. These three banks were there in more than 6-7 decades. So when those people were the younger people can't, younger banks can't come and play around with these people because Sri Lanka is a small market, right? Remember the population is 21 million. So we are comparing a population of 1,352 billion. So remember the population of India, 1.3 billion. That means 1,352 million. So can you if you take 1,352, look at the last two digits, 52. We are only 21 million. There are 1,352 million. Just think about the market size of those banks. India is a bigger population, more than India, the China, 1.4 billion population. That means they have a population of 1,462 million. That means 1.4 billion. Don't get confused. When I say 1.4 billion, mean 1,400 millions. So we are only 21 million or 22 million. We are comparing about 1,450 million with 21 million. So you can just imagine what a tiny market we are, right? So that is how these banks went out. So you can see HSBC, Standard Chartered Bank, HSBC is Hong Kong based. Incorporated in Hong Kong, it goes to HSBC. They have the New York presence. Standard Chartered Bank is a UK bank. Citibank is a New York, USA bank. Deutsche is a German bank. Bank of China, by name of that, is Bank of China, is a China bank. MCB, any idea what is the bank? MCB and IB, Muslim Commercial and IBS, HBL, both are Pakistani bank. Then we have three Indian bank. What is public bank? Which country public bank? Anybody? Which country is public bank? Malaysia. Malaysia. Public bank Berhad. Berhad is the part of Malaysia, right? Then look at the local bank.
What was that gone out of the list? ICICI?
Axis. AXIS. Axis Bank.
Axis Bank. Oh, thank you.
Right. Local commercial bank. Local commercial bank, there are 13 local commercial bank. Out of these local commercial bank, there are two state-owned bank, Bank of Ceylon, People's Bank. HNB, Commercial, Sampath, Ceylon, NDB, Nation Trust, DFCC, Amana, Pan-Asia Union and Cargill. So you can see these are the local 13 banks, out of which two are state-owned bank. So altogether, how many banks in Sri Lanka now? 11 plus 13, how many? 24 bank. Earlier it was 26, with including ICICI and Axis Bank, 26. Now we have 24 banks, right? Okay, now this is the capital requirement currently. In Sri Lanka, domestically incorporated commercial bank should have 10 billion their capital. A branch of a foreign bank should have 5 billion minimum capital. And specialized bank should have 5 billion capital. But what happened? Internationally, we are adopting this Basel standard, right? Basel standard means actually in brief, Basel is a place in Switzerland, right? BACL, Basel. Basel is a place in Switzerland where the first time in, if you take history, there are G8 countries, their central bank and the finance minister went and met in a place called Basel. And they were discussing about all the banking failures and how the banking should be improved globally. So that Basel convention become time to come drastically. They have discussing frequently. They started issuing recommendation. That is what the Basel recommendation 1, Basel 2. Now currently Sri Lanka implementing Basel 3. All over globally, everybody following Basel 3 requirement. According to the Basel 3 requirement, central bank is supposed to increase the capital of the bank. Because they say, Basel 3 say, your bank capital should be increased. Accordingly, our bank's capital should be increased. Actually, it was originally planned to increase 2020, this last year. But we couldn't do it because of this COVID and all. But by 22, all the banks should have their capital almost double. See, 10 billion become 20 billion local banks. Specialized bank, it was 5 billion becomes 7.5 billion. They are increased by 2.5. But commercial bank almost doubled. 10 become 20. Foreign bank, according to the asset base, if it is less than 100 million asset base, they have to have 5 billion. If the asset base is more than 100 billion, they should have 10 billion. So this is the capital requirement by 2022. We are 2 more years. By next year, end of next year, every bank should increase their capital base. Why do you think everybody focusing capital base? You must understand this. Whenever bank will have more capital, if the bank take the depositors money and they start lending to the different businesses, if the businesses fail and there are financial losses, say you are giving a loan and the particular borrower doesn't repay the loan, his businesses fail, right? Then what happened? He's unable to repay. Then bank has to absorb that loss. They can't tell the depositors because though they have given the depositors money to the business, but when their businesses fail, they can't tell the depositors, look here, your money has been given in the form of business. Now the businesses fail, we are unable to repay. Then the financial system gone. So you can't have that. That is the reason every regulator, whether nationally or internationally, when you are into banking business, you should have your own capital always at a higher capital. The higher capital will allow you to higher absorption capacity. Higher absorption capacity means when there is a losses come, you have to absorb from your capital, not from the depositors' money. Remember that. You have been given by regulator to lend the money by taking the deposit. That doesn't mean when you are lending it to the wrong people, if the loan become bad, you can't pass on the losses to the depositors. You have to absorb it because you have taken own risk to grant a loan. So remember, the banks are expected to always keep a higher capital. What is the reason? Simple answer, you have to be careful. When the banks have been requested to keep more capital, the simple reason becomes the absorption capacity of the losses need to be absorbed by the bank. Therefore, they have to have an enhanced capital. Always enhanced capital, right? Okay. You can just note down under this, you can just write down and say, I have put something to write here. You can just mention here, say, banks are expected to banks are expected to maintain a minimum level of capital. Banks are expected to maintain a minimum level of capital. Banks are expected to maintain minimum level of capital as per the respective regulators. As per their respective regulators. as per their respective regulators. This is because this is because when banks take depositors' funds, when bank take depositors' funds and rearrange such funds to lend to different businesses, rearrange such funds to lend to different businesses. In this exercise, banks are exposed to more risk, such as default risk of the borrower, comma, market risk stemming from external factors. So classic example, now see market risk, what is stemming from external factors is a pandemic. Anybody thought this kind of pandemic will come? All the businesses got affected. Have you ever five-star hotel people, when they want to expand, they are taken millions of money to upgrade their rooms, to expand their hotels, to have other location, they would have invested in. Everything stands still. This is something external factors never expected for. So when you are lending it to businesses, you are diversifying your loan portfolio to different businesses. So in this process, the banks are exposed to more risk, especially the default risk and the market risk stemming from external factors, right? Should put the bank into financial crisis. They are into real problem now. They are all the loans have become bad. Now they are into real financial crisis. In this type of situation, then continue to write and say, these financial risks could be absorbed by the capital deployed by the banks. Capital deployed by the banks. So now you know why regulators are asking banks to keep more capital, because banks are doing a risky business. They take the depositors' money and going and giving it the loan to everybody. That loan can be one is the default. The borrower is unable to pay. What is the reason unable to pay is willfully a default. There are instances mostly external factor affecting the business. These are the main reasons. So due to these reasons, when they don't get the loan paid, they can't pass the depositors to these losses to the depositor. They have to absorb, right? So then finally, you can make a last sentence and say, banks cannot transfer the financial risk to the depositors. Banks cannot transfer the financial risk. Bank cannot transfer the financial risk to their depositors. Instead, they should absorb by their own capital. Capital and reserves. Okay. Then we'll move on to the other slides. Okay. There are regulatory requirement, right? There are regulatory requirement on life and commercial banks. So if you really look at it, all the banks in Sri Lanka should know what are the act impacting them, maybe directly, maybe indirectly, right? So the Monetary Law Act is, it's an act that is only given the license banks to carry out the businesses. So you should know that act will specify the requirement bank has to fulfill. The number one act is Monetary Law Act, Banking Act. These are the two major acts impacting the bank. So I have given the act number and the year, right? Abbreviation MLM stand for Monetary Law Act, right? Monetary Law Act, Banking Act. There are acts you can have enactment amendment, but this is the origin of the act, right? Monetary Law Act, then Banking Act, Foreign Exchange Act, which was a replacement of early Exchange Control Act. So the Foreign Exchange Act brought in about 2 years ago, 2017, about 3 years ago. A Foreign Exchange Act, right? It was the replacement of Exchange Control Act. The Exchange Control Act is no more since 2017. Earlier it was Exchange Control, now it goes as Foreign Exchange Act, right? Then you have Payment and Settlement System Act. All payment, I told you, the bank facilitating all kind of payments. So there is a act to handle that payment also. That's why you call Payment and Settlement System Act. As I told you, 2005-06, there were three acts on Financial Intelligence Unit. So that is, one is for Convention of Suppression of Terrorist Financing Act. Convention and Suppression of Terrorist Financing Act. Then Prevention of Money Laundering Act. You have to prevent the money laundering. Prevention of Money Laundering Act. Then I told you suspicious transaction need to be reported under the last act, Financial Transaction Reporting Act. So if you get a question, briefly explain what are the acts that are directly impacting the bank's operation or the commercial bank. So you should remember to write at least 5 acts, right? Monetary Law Act, Banking Act, Foreign Exchange Act, Payment and Settlement Act. Then you have 3, Anti-Money Laundering, that is Prevention of Money Laundering, Convention and Suppression of Terrorist Financing Act, then Financial Transaction Reporting Act, right? Okay, these are the act that every bank should aware of. Then in addition to that, you have Law Income Tax, Import Export Control Act, Customs Act. There are so many acts, but I have only given the key acts that are mainly governed by the banks, right? So let us briefly just go through what type of function commercial bank does. Accepting deposit, yes, you know, they grant loans and advances. Yeah, they do the payment, fund transfers, money transfers. They facilitating the trade payment guarantees. They give the advices to the businesses, financial and corporate. Corporate mean bigger companies. They do the leasing. They do the pawning. Pawning, you know, the gold advances, again, gold article, pawning. There are different banking concept called Islamic banking. Then you have digital banking. There, the delivery channel. Everybody talks about the delivery channel now. Every bank is doing virtual banking. You call it digital banking. All banks are done on internet, via internet and digital banking. These are some of the function of the commercial bank. Major financial market. If you look at the market, it is not a physical place. It's generally you carry out those transaction through this organization become market, right? Money markets are short-term financial instrument like treasury bill, bank deposit, all that's how you call money market. Capital market is always long-term investment. Capital, when you, the capital is long-term, shares, equity, debentures, all that is capital, treasury bond, all are comes under capital market. Foreign exchange market, yes, buying, selling foreign exchange market. Debt market, debt is when you issue debt. These, remember, these markets sometimes call, depending on the instrument also, you call this market as a debt market. So debt market means whenever you want to collect your capital by issuing debt instrument. Suppose say a bank or a public quoted company want to collect money from the people by issuing shares, you call equity market or equity market. Equity, when a company issues shares and collect their capital, you call equity or equity market by issuing shares. Sometimes the company want to borrow from the general public. Then they issue debentures. That market you call debt market. Debt. Debt market means they are borrowing from general public by issuing a debentures. Debentures is debt market instrument, right? Or bonds. Bonds. Debentures and bonds are called debt market. Equity market, you are offering shares to the general public. Selling, public quoted companies are collecting their capital by issuing shares. Those are the companies that are quoted in the Colombo Stock Exchange. So you should know in company in Sri Lanka, there are two type of company, private company, public quoted company. So within the name, you get PVT, within bracket, you get PVT, all are private company. Those companies collected their capital from the members itself. They can't collect the money from the public by issuing shares. Of course, the public quoted company, right? All the public quoted company collected money by issuing shares to the general public. Those companies are called public quoted company. So you should know in Sri Lanka, there are two type of company, private company, public. If you say Pereira and Sons, it's a private company, right? But if you think of John Keels, it's a public quoted company. If you think Dialogue is a public quoted company because they issue shares to the general public. So the private is generally family concern. Stafford Motors, Pereira and Sons, likewise, so many, you get so many business private companies, right? Public quoted, bigger corporate issuing shares to the general public, those companies called public quoted company. Then the primary secondary market, when a public quoted company first time coming into the market and issuing shares, that market become a primary market. So you can see, though the title says financial market, these markets are called based on the instrument, based on the activity. So there is no physical place as a market here, right? Remember, sometimes looking at the instrument also, we will call it as a debt market. That means they are issuing, they are borrowing from general public by issuing a debenture. That market is called debt market. Equity market or equity market by issuing shares, right? Then the primary market, first time, when you are first time coming to the market, issuing shares, you call IPO, initial public offering. How do you call that? IPO. IPO means when a public quoted company first time issuing shares to the general public, collecting their capital called IPO, initial public offering. That is done in a primary market. Secondary market, once the shares are sold in the primary market, those shares are traded in the secondary market. Right? So if I give you an example, let's say there's a new bank going to come. Right? They are issuing the shares in the primary market. So whenever whoever buying the share, they will put a paper advertisement and they will say, we are issuing the shares. We are the new bank going to form in Sri Lanka. We are from China. We are going to form a Chinese bank here. So maybe a local entity going to form a bank. It could be both way. Either way, that could be fun. Now we can see foreign company, IOC came, Lanka Indian Oil Company came. They issue shares and collect the capital. People bought the shares. IOC have been permitted to issue capital in Sri Lanka. There are people who are holding IOC shares. It's a public quoted company. Likewise, there could be a resident company or a foreign company can come and form incorporated here, and then under public quoted company they can sell the shares and collect the capital. So when they are coming to the first time, you call primary market. So if a new bank come, you are going to buy their shares, that is done in a primary market. Once the shares is done, issued, everybody, then whatever shares you bought, you want to resell, you have to go to the secondary market, right? Then you have financial infrastructure, that is to settle all the payment, you call financial infrastructure, right? Now we have after going through the first session, you know, if there is no bank, we are seeing the history of the banking. We have gone through different time, different interval. Now currently we have come up to digital banking level. Now where would you go to borrow money? If there is no bank, look at the title. If there were no banks, where do you go to the borrow? No places. Nobody going to give you money. Only the place you can go to is the bank. So you can see the existence of the bank going to be there forever, because there is no place for you to go and borrow. So why the banks are so important, you can see this question. What will you do with your savings? No, you can't go to anywhere. You have excess money. Can you go to anybody and give the money to anybody? No, you don't. You will rather you keep the money. You never know what will happen when you give it to somebody. Right? So you can see how important the banks, what is the bank playing role, right? Would you be able to borrow as much as you need when you need it in the form convenient? No, there's no other place. What risk might you face as a saver, as a borrower? No, first of all, nobody will give the money. There are in economy, there are two people, one group of people with excess money. They are the savers. The other people want to save money. There is the other sect of people who are borrowers, who are looking for money to do businesses. Can these two people meet and do the transaction? No. So you can see in an economy, without the bank, these two sectors are just a sector. But by banks coming in the middle of these two sectors, only the economy booming. The economy is there because of the banks. If the bank is not there in an economy, there is no economy without the banks, in simple words. So how important the banks are. That is how these questions are there. The bottom line, read the bottom line. Banks have come long way from temple and ancient world. Yes, we have gone through that. But their basic business practice have not changed. What is the basic practice? Safekeeping. You have to lend the money, fractional reserve, all are the basic. All the history has altered the fine points of the business model. The bank's purpose is to make loans, protect depositors' money. Yes, that is going to be there forever. Even after 2 years, even under 200 years, you and me, maybe not here in this world. There are other society going to study. We are in the history. We have gone into history. But they might also look at the current situation. Maybe they will say in 2020, the banking went up to different concept called digital, electronic. And they will think about the way we bank. But the requirement of bank continue to be there. So even if the future task banks completely off from your street corner onto the internet as to shopping for loans across the bank will still exist. Remember the bottom line. The bank will still exist to perform this primary function. So there's no way bank could be taken off from your economy, right? So I don't know whether you got the, have they shared you the note one? You got a separate note from IBSL? Yes or no? Have you all got the note from IBSL? Have they shared you? Yes or no, please?
Yes.
No, sir.
No, yes or no? No. Okay, I will tell them to share with you the notes because I send them a note. I think we are going to look at so I will tell them to share with you the notes. Please go through the notes. There are a few questions I have given. Try to answer your question by going through the
So
whatever.
we got the note.
Ah, you got the note, right? You got the note, right? So in that note, there were some question, right? Last, look at the last page. Have I given some question in the note?
Yes, sir, there are four questions.
Ah, right. Try to answer those questions. So we will discuss when you have a time. So we are moving into the second session. You can see the slide, right? Everybody can see the slides.
Yes,
Can
sir,
see the slide?
screen. Yes, sir, screen is
Okay.
visible.
Okay. Right. So now we are going to look at the banking business, right? What is the fundamental of bank? Now we left over from the bottom line. Pick up the bottom line. What is bottom line says? The banks are doing different finer points. Banks come up to this level, but banks' role cannot be replaced by anybody. So, what is the fundamental of the banking? The fundamental of the banking, if you take any economy, you have one set of people with the excess money. You have other set of people who is requiring for a money. You call deficit unit, excess unit, deficit unit. So the if these two units are in the economy, can the economy function? No way. Somebody has to come a middleman. Somebody has to come as a middleman, right? So the who comes as a middleman? That is the bank. That is the role of the bank. So the banks comes as a middleman. Banks have been empowered by the regulator. Okay, you can accept deposit. Now people are coming and depositing their money to the bank. Why people are coming? Because they know this particular bank is monitored by the regulator. They have been supervised. They have been given a license. So their operations are supervised by the regulator. Now people have the confidence because the central bank is the government bank, apex of the financial infrastructure system in Sri Lanka. And they come and tell you they are the licensed commercial bank. So when they're given the license, people are confident. Now the people who have the excess money, they don't need to go to the borrower and think of the borrower whether to give the money. So you can see if the banks are there, they don't have any problem. They come and simply deposit the money according to their tenure. If I want some money to be retained with the bank for 2 to 3 years, I will go and put the money into the fixed deposit. If I want to do, if I want some money, I want to save for a future, I may go and put it in the savings account. Or I may open a business account and start doing business in the bank by opening a current account. So there are people come and deposit the money with the bank. So bank is offered interest rate to the depositors, right? Bank offers interest rate based on the whatever rate given by the central bank, they offer a rate. They know by end of that particular period, they will be paid interest by the bank. Now, what is bank got to do with this money? Bank will collect those depositors' money and repackage those money and giving it to different people as a loan. But what is in this exercise, remember, bank is taking undue risk because bank has to see whether this particular person who is borrowing from the bank is capable of repaying the loan. If the borrower doesn't repay the loan, the bank has to absorb the loss. The bank will never going to prepare to absorb the loss. So they don't want to give it any loan. That is the reason sometimes you see people are talking to take a loan from a bank is very difficult. Because when you go to bank to borrow a loan, they always say very difficult to take a loan from a bank. Why? Why it's difficult? Because it is not the bank money, it is the depositor's money bank gives a loan. So the bank take most precaution when they give the loan. When before they extend the loan, they take lot of question. They will talk to you, they will interview you, they will collect a lot of information from you, they not only that, they will take a ask you to give an asset, a security, collateral. Why the collateral is required? Because when you are unable to pay, they want to recover the loan. So they are asking everything. Why? Because this is the depositor's money. So remember, this is the fundamental of banking. So bank come as an intermediary. Remember the bank role. Bank comes as an intermediary between the savers and the borrowers. They take the savers money and giving it to the borrowers and collect more interest from the borrowers and repay the depositors. So always bank pay according to the rate offered by central bank, and bank charge loan depending on the tenor of the loan. Bank charge more interest from the loan, so bank earn more interest from the loan and repay the depositor, and the balance interest are their interest income. So that is how the bank generate income. So the major source of income bank generate, take the depositors money and lending it to different businesses and earn interest. So there are two things happening. You have to pay depositors interest. You have to collect interest from the borrowers. So you collect more interest and you pay the depositors. So definitely when you pay 2.5 for the savings deposit, maybe 4 to 5% for the fixed deposit. When you are giving a loan, you may charge about 10 to 12% and you are charging more because you are taking a risk. You need to pay the depositors, so you are charging more. So this is the role. This is what you call financial intermediary. What is the role of financial intermediary? Banks come as a middle person between two parties to manage the financial transaction. Who are the two parties? One is the people keeping the money, savers. They are having a money, they are looking for a person to give. There are other side, there are borrowers, people who want to spend into business, they are looking for a money. So bank comes in between these two parties. That function is called, remember, financial intermediation. The banks operate as a financial intermediary. So financial, if you get a question, remember to write. So these are the questions you can score more marks. What is the financial intermediation? So the bank acts as a financial intermediary between two economic units. What are the two economic units? One is savers, other one is borrowers. These two units, banks come in between because banks have been authorized by the regulator. So bank take the depositor's money, repackages those money into different tenor and granting into different loan. So their loan need to be diversified. Remember, why when you are giving a loan into diversify? Or when you are investing also, why do people say don't invest in one place, go and invest into different? What is the reason? Can anybody tell me that? So you have a money, everybody tell, don't put everything, don't put all the eggs into one basket. Why do they say, there's a phrase, don't put all the eggs into one basket. What is the reason? If the basket is broken or something happened to the basket, entire eggs gone. So likewise, if you put all the money into one bank, the bank collapse. Or if you put all the, if you go and give it to the loan to one bigger company, if the bigger company collapse, the entire money gone. So that is what you always remember, diversify. The bank has to diversify the loan. Not only bank by your, in its own diversify. Even regulator says, don't give the loan only to one segment, because regulator come and tell the bank, look here, you have been permitted to accept the depositors from the general public, but we will also tell you to whom to grant loan. So they will come and tell you, okay, you have to grant 10% of your total loan books to the agriculture, 10% to the tourism, 10% to the SME sector, 10% to the export sector. Maybe young women are there, young men are there. Give 5%, 5%. Likewise, central bank also give the direction to the commercial bank to whom to grant loan, right? So you that is because central bank also wants banks to diversify their loan portfolio. Now you might feel a bank is very comfortable giving every loan to a particular businesses, earn more interest, and they are very well happy. But central bank not going to allow that to happen, because central bank want banks to diversify their loan portfolio, because as in an economy, You have an agricultural sector. We are being an agricultural country. We have an agricultural sector. We have a SME. We have a tourism. Right? We have a export. Right? There are other young people are there. So you have to diversify the loan portfolio. So that is what the bank's role is, intermediary. So what is financial intermediary? Remember, bank come as a middleman between two economic units. One is savers, other one is borrowers. So bank take the depositors' money and lending it to the different businesses. When bank take deposit, they have to pay interest. When bank give loans, they have to recover the interest. So they charge interest from the borrowers and pay the depositors, and the balance, whatever excess interest they earn, that is their interest profit. That is how traditionally bank make bigger profit, by charging more interest. But in recent time, you can see the interest rates are very low. Now, bank can't earn more income from interest because the rates are very low now. And even central bank comes and say to the commercial bank, you can't give loans more than a certain percentage. Earlier, it was not like that. They will say you can pay depositors, but when you are lending out of your way, you can lend. But they now come and tell, okay, credit card, you can't charge. Pawning, you can't charge more than that. Now they are putting a ceiling. So the bank can't have their own interest rate and lend loan. That also reduced. So as a result, what is happening? The income bank generates from traditionally net interest margin. That means the difference between interest earned from the loans and interest payable to the depositors, the difference between these are net interest margin. This net interest margin is gradually reducing and reducing. Why? The interest rates are very low. And the central bank also putting a ceiling on the loans. So when the central bank put a ceiling on the loans, bank can earn more interest now. That is what they are focusing into other areas.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, tell me.
Sir, this duty is not available in the classroom.
Okay. Okay, no worry. Okay, no worry. I will tell them to share with you. Let me see whether I can show you the, whether I have it finally. I think, no, sorry. This is a note I think I have given you. You can see the note. Can you see the note?
Yes, sir.
This note I will tell them to share with you, right? This is the note I given you. This is the note. This is the note number one I given you. I think I asked you some question also. I said that all that is there.
Sir, we got this one. We didn't receive the second lesson.
Second lesson you will get it. Second lesson you will get it. Everybody got the first one, right? This is the first one I took. I was telling you, and this one you have.
All we got this one.
You got this one, right? Fine. Yeah. This is the question I want you all to try. There are five questions. Uh-huh. Somebody said four. Is there five? Right? Five question, right?
Yes, sir.
Five question. Try to answer this question by next class. If time permit, we'll discuss. Right. So moving back to, right. So I will share with you the second notes during this week, right? You will get the second note. Right. So the importance of financial intermediation, right? It's a vital role banks play in the economy. Yes, of course, without the bank, there is no economy. So you can see in the economy, there are savers, there are borrowers. Bank comes as, if the bank doesn't come, there is no liquidity to the economy. So just think, when there is a no bank, one segment with excess money, there are other segments waiting to take money to do businesses. Without the bank, can these people go and meet the people who want some money? Let's say one person is there, he has 1 million rupees excess money. He want to give the loan. He go and meet somebody recommend, there is one person, he can do business. He will go and meet that particular person. But that person wants 5 million loan. So there is no matching requirement here. He has only 1 million, but this person wants 5 million. or this person has only 100,000, this person wants 2 million. So just imagine, is it possible for the borrower to borrow? How many individuals you have to go and meet and convince? Totally not possible. Not at all possible. So you can see how important the role bank plays in the economy. Without the bank, nothing will move. So if there is no bank, there is no economy at first place. And if there is bank, since bank is there only, these money taken from the excess units are gone into the bank as a deposit. These deposits are repackaged in the form of loans and given into each and every segment in the economy who are desperate to do the businesses. Of course, they charge interest, they assess the credit worthiness of each borrower, they do the thorough exercise, because end of the day, they should know if the borrower doesn't pay, they can't pass the financial losses to the depositors. Instead, they have to absorb it. Therefore, they are to very keen in selecting borrowers are very keen. That is the toughest role. Taking depositors is not a big role. If you put an advertisement, the inflow will come in. People, everybody will come and deposit the money. That is not a bigger thing at all. But remember, lending is the toughest job in the bank. Because when you are lending it to the different people, your major anticipation is to get that particular borrower to repay the loan as agreed, including the interest. If he doesn't pay the interest, how can you pay the depositor's interest? Right? If the depositors want the money back, where is the money? You are given in the form of a loan. You are not getting interest. You are not getting the loan repaid. See the financial losses. So you have to be very selective when you are granting loan, right? That is what we are going to learn in this. So why financial intermediary important? They play a vital role. And remember, the cost involved, if the bank is not there, the depositors has to incur a lot of cost to find the suitable person to lend. They have to collect information. They have to go and meet the person. And the lender may not in a position to give any information, every business information to the other person who has the excess money. Since banks are there, all these activities are looked after by the expertise of a people. Banks as expertise people. They do credit analysis. They do all the study. So it is very much, as far as the depositors is concerned, without incurring any excess expenditure, he simply comes and deposits the money and enjoys the interest. That is because banks are there. So you can see, if the banks are not there, can the depositors go and give the direct loan to the borrower? No way. He can't give. If you want to give information, if you want to give a loan to a direct loan, he has to collect more information about the borrower. Practically, it is not possible. Even though if he try, he has to spend a lot of money, right? To collect information, analyze the information, and see the business focuses, whether this particular... Now, all these exercises are done by the bank. Therefore, both people are easily, simply, their cost of funds are minimized. Simply, the excess people, depositors, or the savers are, without any additional expenses, they are getting the interest income. So, it's a value-added service to them. If you take the borrower, without any additional cost, he's just borrowing. If the banks are not there, he has to go and convince every depositors to get the loan. He may have to meet 100 people to get one loan. Because every depositor has a small money. But when it comes to bank pool all the money. Bank collect all the money. And one shot is making 5 million. They say there is a business person want to come and take 5 million loan. Bank has 1 million of depositors. Bank has billions of money. Now, giving 5 million is nothing for the bank. So, how easy for the borrower to burn at one shot 5 million? He has to give the proper business proposal. And he has to give the repayment capacity. He has to show the forecasted cash flow for him to repay the loan. These requirements, if he fully get at one shot. So, you can see in an economy, by intermediation role, banks save a cost. Very convenient to do operation. So you have to write a lot of benefits. And bank is diversifying the risk. So one is diversify risk mean you are. So if 100 people are giving it to the one person, if the business is failed, the entire 100 people are going to suffer. Now they are giving in the deposit to the bank. Bank look after the diversify. The depositors need not to worry. Even a business fail, bank is going to absorb the loss, not the depositors. Now see how benefit are deposited. Both economy, both sector in the economy are benefited because of the bank's intermediation role. What is this maturity transformation? Now maturity means the period, right? Now look at the savings people. Now say there is one person come to the bank and say, I want this money to be put in the savings account. So he can come and take anytime any money, right? He savings account. There is a one person coming and say, I keep my fixed deposit for 1 year, here 10 million. So he keep the money for 1 year, fixed deposit, right? So you can see all the depositors are coming with a very short maturity period. Maximum 1 year they keep the money. But when the business person come, he wants a 5 million loan for 10 years. Now you can see the difference. By the way, now when bank take deposits and when bank grant loans, now I want to ask you a question. I think I forgot to ask the question. Now tell me, bank's point of view, the depositors are assets or liability? Bank's point of view, depositors are, bank's point of view, how do the bank consider deposit? Liability. Why? Liability. They have to pay the deposit. Yes, liability. But remember, when the bank give the loans to the borrowers, bank treat them borrowers as what? Assets. Why? Borrower has to repay the loan to the bank. So remember, now you are learning two things. Depositors are liability in the bank balance sheet. So remember, if you look at the balance sheet of the bank, on the liability side, the bigger amount reflecting the liability sides are deposits, right? In the bank balance sheet asset side, the bigger figure will be loans and advances. Why? When bank give loans and advances, those people has to repay. So bank treat in their books deposits as liability, loans and advances are assets. That is the fundamental you learn, right? So just jot down some notes here. Just take a notes and say, financial intermediation. Banks act as financial, you can put a FI, you need not write everything. Financial intermediation, you can put a FI. Bank, don't write in exam, don't go and write in exam FI, yeah? You have to write the full. For the short notes, you can save time, I put FI. Yeah? If financial institutions, FI stand for, but here I'm referring financial intermediaries. Huh? Generally, FI stand for financial institution. But here, what I meant is financial intermediary. Right? Banks act as FI between savers, S-A-V-E-R-S, savers and borrowers. Savers and borrowers. Then next line you can say, savers place their deposit with banks and receive interest, and they can withdraw funds too. They can withdraw funds too. Banks, then you can say banks accept the depositors' funds. Banks accept the depositors' funds, repackages repackages banks accept the depositors fund and repackages into loan repackages loans and advances repackages into loans and advances repackages into loans and advances granted to the borrowers granted to the suitable 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 borrowers as per the loan agreement as per the loan term as per the loan agreement as per the loan agreement borrowers are as per the loan agreement borrowers are expected to borrowers are expected to pay interest and loan installment as agreed borrowers are expected to pay interest and loan installment pay interest and loan installments right full stop therefore bank plays a middle role between a bank or bank plays a middle role between two different economic units such as excess units and deficit units. Banks play a middle role between excess unit and the deficit units. By continue to perform this role, Banks facilitating to the economy the required liquidity. Liquidity is cash. Bank facilitating to the economy the required liquidity. Let us look at this. What is maturity transformation? As I told you, bank take the depositors, of course, very short tenure, maybe 1 year. Every deposit comes savings account, term deposit, everything very short maturity. So the liabilities of the banks are very short maturity. Deposits are liability, very short maturity. But when it comes to asset, the loans and advances, the maturities are, the borrowers are asking longer period to repay the loan because they are going to use this money into the business. They can't do the business 1 year. they want to use 5 years, 10 years, right? Say somebody coming for a housing loan, he may ask 20 years. The bank is going to give a housing loan for the person to put up a housing for 20 years. So you can see always the asset sides are require longer maturity. So what is the, there is a maturity transformation. The bank is transferring the short-term liabilities into the long-term assets. Then you can see the maturity transformation is high risk. Suppose say, if everybody depositors come and demand the money, can the bank has a liquidity? No, they don't have. That is what you call maturity mismatch. The maturity is mismatching here. Yeah, the deposits are taken, the deposits liabilities are shorter maturity, but the assets and loans and advances, which is assets, are longer maturity. But by practice, remember by practice, bank knows, this is what you have to understand. By practice, bank knows, though on the face of it, it is short-term maturity, but short-term maturity, the deposits are short-term maturity. By in actually, the deposits are also going to be there for a long term. Bank knows only maybe 5 to 10 people from the savings account, they pull out the money. Balance 90% of the savings account funds are there forever. So by practice, bank knows, though their maturity mismatches on the face of it, in reality, banks can retain such deposit for a longer period. In the event, if they want a longer maturity, they might even can borrow. So remember, the banks are not only dependent on depositors. They also can borrow from anybody, foreign or anybody, they can borrow, right? They can borrow at a lower rate also. Sometimes when you depositors asking for 2.5, when the fixed deposit people only can come 5% only when you want a deposit, bank can go and borrow at the rate of 3% from a foreign bank. That is cheaper for a bank. Why? They borrow for 5 years loan from a foreign bank at the rate of 3% is cheaper than take a FD from a general public. The general public give the FD, they expecting a 6% rate. Then only they put a fixed deposit. Then again, they only put for 1 year. But this bank is borrowing a loan from a company at a longer tenor. So you must remember, bank's deposit side, bank will not only solely, though the bank balance sheet, the bigger portion of the liability side is no doubt is deposits. Deposit only the major side. But there are other units bank can take money. Bank can borrow also. Remember these two things. Bank can take the banks as a bank has a balance sheet, which has a liability side, which has asset side. The liability side, the bigger portion is deposits. There is no doubt about it. But there are smaller quantity bank can borrow also from a foreign bank. So remember, bank's source of money can come in different forms. It can come from different sources. Short term, they can borrow from short term. Even they can borrow from long term from a lending organization. And then they can lend it to longer term borrowers. So these are the people who want to take money from the general public. So you should know what is maturity transformation. Maturity means the shorter maturity transform into longer maturity. So in this case, there could be a situation when the maturity mismatches in adversely affect the bank. There could be a situation if everybody come and demand the money at once, bank into problem. That is what some banks into problem. That is because their maturities are mismatching. But remember, in practice, the maturity mismatch are there in every organization. Banks very well are, they can't match. The maturity of the deposit is 1 year, then they can't give the loan anything more than 1 year. It's possible to loan 1 year, nobody can go 1 year, but of course the liabilities are shorter maturity. But practice, they know, though the liability on the face of it shorter maturity, in reality, most of the deposit is going to retain the money with the bank. Therefore, bank is very well aware to use this money to lend it to the longer term. But in the event, if something went wrong, say something going wrong due to some bad economics, recession or whatever comes, then you have a bigger problem. Then you are into problem. Then you have to go to the central bank as a lender to last resort to sort out this problem. So you should understand what is maturity mismatch. So you can continue to write and say, you can continue to say, maturity transformation means bank maturity transformation means bank takes short-term deposits and grant long term loans and advances. Therefore, the short term liabilities are transforming into long term assets. Long-term assets. Long-term assets. Full stop. This type of situation. This type of situation is identified as maturity. This type of situation is identified as maturity mismatch between liabilities and assets. Liabilities and assets, right? Then you can continue to write and say, in reality, banks are very well aware through their experience and expertise knowledge the short term deposits are kept for longer period. Short term deposits are kept for longer period. Longer period. As savers, intention is to save money for the future. As saver's intention is to, as the saver's intention is to save money as much as possible, save money as much as possible for future use. Save money as much as possible for the future use. As much as possible for future use. For future use. Therefore, this maturity transformations are, therefore, the maturity transformations are efficiently handled by the banks, are efficiently handled by the banks. Are efficiently handled by the bank. Efficiently handled by the bank. Full stop. However, you have to write, however, in the event of unexpected, however, in the event of unexpected, however, in the event of unexpected withdrawals of deposits, unexpected withdrawal of deposits, in the event of unexpected withdrawal of deposits, Banks might face liquidity shortage. Bank might face liquidity shortage. Liquidity means cash form. Liquidity shortage. Liquidity shortage. Liquidity shortage. So you should know, right, that in the end of the day, as far as bank is very well managing the maturity between the short-term liabilities from the deposits and the long-term assets, they are doing it. But they very well aware the short terms are, though the face of it short term, generally depositors are kept for a long term. Though it's short term, but generally happens, what happens, people are saving money for the future use, so they keep it for a longer period. But further, remember, bank also mindful, bank also try to keep this deposit for a longer period. They are also having some items, some accounts they introduce. So in order to keep the money, that is what you would have seen the minor savings account. So one of the best tool you promote. Why every bank going to the college and school and start minor saving? Because the moment mine open account, that money going to be there until they attend major. So that is a 50, if the child comes at the age of 5 or 6, until the child attains at the age of 18. So you have up to 12 years their depositors. That is what every bank going behind is minor. Wherever there is opportunity, they immediately grab the opportunity when it comes to minor account. Because minor accounts are the best tool to have the deposit on a longer term. Right? So that is one of the tools, right? So I think I have taken your extra time. So we will try to do the exercise, these questions that I shared you. I think these are the questions. You know how the bank is in economy. In economy, without the bank, you can write it. Huh? Without the bank's involvement, there is no economy. So the key role played by a bank in economy, you know now. Differentiate commercial bank with a specialized bank. Yeah. What is the different factor? Right. That you learn probably, you know by now, but try to understand what is the difference, right? List down five local, I think we discussed some laws, right? Monetary law, bank law, that you need to write about five. What happened if the SRR is reduced, right? But the name, what is the name of the rate that would apply the absorption of overnight excess liquidity? Yeah, we saw two rates, standing deposit, standing lending. What is the rate applicable here? So simple question. Try to keep the answer ready by the next week. We'll meet you in the next week. Okay. Then see you in the next week.
Thank you, sir.